For four previous seasons, the field sizes have grown larger. For four previous seasons, the competition has grown tougher. For a handful of drivers, the Season 5 championship is there for the taking. For most everyone else, it will be as elusive to grasp as a feather in the breeze. This is the Blondies MX5 World Tour. Presented by the Quality Racing Syndicate.
Channel. I'm your host, Joe Peek. With me in the booth is the knowledgeable Richard Losper. Behind the curtain, directing all the cameras and turning all the knobs and making sure you miss none of the racing action, is Giancarlo Lenzi. Joining us a little later will be the indomitable Ayrton Ellis. Welcome, guys.
Hi, Joe. Hi, Giancarlo.
This is Season 5 of Blondie's MX5 World Tour. Today's race is held on the short version of the lovely Okayama International Circuit. This is a 40-lap race, and at only 1.3 miles long, you can expect traffic to come into play today. There are some returning faces as well as some new talent in the league. Jan Koemans was actually supposed to be here today to defend his title, but it appears he's a no-show, which is unusual. We'll have to see how that plays out in the field. But there's also some newcomers that are looking to topple Jan and his title defense. Amjad Yamin is probably one of those eager faces looking to make his stamp on this popular and history league. Other familiar faces are looking to topple the incredibly fast Koemans. Douglas Beard, Jer Janis, Arcadius Tatirix, Nico Brandt, Tom Rathy, and Sam McAleer are all usually very close behind and ready to snatch victory from the quick Belgian. Unfortunately, a few other top contenders in the league will also miss the season opener. Guillerme Reto, Dexter Castro, and Tumas Hallinen are also unable to make today's race, which would have helped clear the path for Koemans, but I guess this gives guys like Tom and Nico a chance to really make up ground. Well, this is a bit of an interesting league, has a bit of unique format and league rules as far as penalty goes. It's your typical race rules as far as passing and rules of the road go, as far as etiquette on the track. But when it comes to the penalties and the marshals handing them out, they actually have a point system. And 1 through 3 points, they only get basically a warning. Just is kind of gives them a heads up that they need to drive a little bit safer and just kind of be careful. Once they get to 4 points, it is a mandatory stop and go. And then once they get to 5 points, it is another mandatory stop and go. If they reach a total of 6 points, it is a one-race suspension, so it gets pretty serious by that point. Anything beyond that, you are definitely in trouble. I believe there is an indefinite ban on the driver with the points. There is also, as far as the points go, there's an interesting little tweak to that. In the 1 through 3 points, the drivers are allowed to do an optional drive-through to lessen their rating. So that's something to keep an eye on today as well. This is a 15-race season with the Blondies MX5 World Tours, and today, as I said, is race one. So there's still a lot yet to go, but those one-race bans could come into play, so they got to keep it clean. Well, Richard, what are we expecting to see today with these cars on the track?
Well, hello, everyone, and welcome to GSRC. I can say to you, Joe, that it's going to be a race of attrition, in my opinion. I have been watching the guys during the practice session, and maybe that was just practice, but it seems to me that there were lots and lots of accidents taking place. But as far as this track goes, you mentioned that it's a 1.3-mile track. That's about 2 kilometers, 2.09 kilometers to be exact. There are 7 turns on this track in the short version. Everyone knows they're not using the long version. So in turn one is actually called the first corner. And it's a reasonably fast sweeping corner. that as you come off the start finish straight, you go right-hander into that first corner. They then go into another corner called, it doesn't have a name, pretty tight, because that's where they sweep off the main course into the cut through, as it were, to get onto the back section of the course. And then they'll go through turn three, Piper corner. They'll follow through into the Redmond corner, and then they right at the rear of the course where they go through Redmond and Hobbs, and they come into the Mike Knight corner, and then sweep down into the last corner before getting back onto the straight. Now, you did mention that there were some good fast guys in here. It is a real pity that the defending champion Jan Koemans has not attended this race. And as I'm watching the qualifying, very early days in the very early minutes, I should say, in the qualifying, but Amjad Yamin at this point in time has set the fastest time at 1 minute and 1 second, 0.586.
I did notice that, and I've raced with Amjad. He's very, very fast. I race with him quite a bit in the Skip Barbers and sometimes in the SRFs, and he's a very powerful force in these lower powered cars. I would agree with you that he is someone to watch out for. I also noticed that right now I'm seeing Chuck Johnson in the number three spot in qualifying at only 0.3 slower than Amjad. He's another guy I've raced with quite a bit in the CESES, and he's quite fast. I would say that, you know, keep an eye on him, because when he keeps it clean, he's definitely going to be up there and fighting for the top positions.
Yes, I don't know. Amjad Yamin wasn't, he was about third or fourth fastest in the practice. Yeri Yanis was second fastest in practice. I noticed that he is now in fifth place in the practice with a time of 1 minute, 01.856. So, and there are other guys that we know as well. Tom Rathie, I see in there. Arthur Chan, who we know quite well from the CESCS League. He's up in the top 10, he's in 8th place at the moment. Kieran Mant, he's a newcomer in this race. I'm not sure whether he's raced in this series before. Nico Brandt's up there as well. And then that pretty much takes care of the top 10, Joe.
Yeah, I've raced with Nico as well in Indy cars, and I'm very curious to see how he fares in these lesser power cars. I know in the Indy cars, he was usually posting setups and whatnot that were very, very helpful. So he's known for setting up a car, even though this is a fixed setup. But I have to imagine that would translate pretty well to these lower cars being able to handle them, because they're not quite as precise as the Indy cars. So I'm pretty sure that he's going to be a force to watch out for. You also mentioned Arthur Chan, who I just saw him get into a little bit of trouble in qualifying there. He's had a bit of bad luck as far as I've seen him race in the past, and I don't think it's typically his fault. He's very clean, but he just has the worst luck. I see him a bit sort of like the Pedro Rodriguez of the MX-5s.
Yes, a couple of names we haven't mentioned yet, and they are starting to show up in the top 10 now in qualifying. We've got João Freitas, Claudio Klima. Now, I know Claudio Klima from the Grand Touring Cup. He has obviously improved a lot from the times that I used to race alongside him, because he at the moment has got a third fastest time in qualifying. Sam McAleer, who we know had a problem with health, but appears to have overcome that now and is back in the league. He's raced in previous series in this league. Arcadius Tedderix. Arcadius is a well-known fast driver in the MX-5. I've raced against him a fair number of times. He's always up there or thereabouts. So I'm expecting a really tough fight up near the top, Joe.
Absolutely. You know, also, we can't forget about the guys down toward the bottom, because they deserve mention, too. Everyone here works really, really hard and puts in plenty of time to practice. into making this race. I see Hiro Kanaya in the 32nd spot currently. I actually raced with him last night in a McLaren league, and he wasn't up towards the front. He was I believe I lapped him a couple times, but he's a very polite driver, I have to say. He was very considerate of the leaders coming by. And with this being such a short circuit, that's probably going to be a deciding factor as to how strategy and just driving, you know, throughout the race, trying to deal with traffic coming through. You're going to want to come across guys like him who are considerate and will give you space and not try and fight you for the spot.
Yes, I know Hiro. We've e-races in the CESCS League as well, in the MX-5 division, and he also races in the Grand Touring Cup. Yes, you're quite right. He is very polite, perhaps too polite, giving up his spot very, very easily to anybody who wants it, basically. And I think he needs to get a little bit tougher if he wants to make a mark on any series that he competes in, Joe.
Yeah, it could definitely play to, you know, to help him establish his reputation. But I think there's something to be said to be known as a polite backmarker, because then you have a lot of guys that are on your side who will want to help you out, share setups, give you tips. Generally, just, you know, when you're not pissing them off, you're gonna get them to be on your side and help you get a little faster that way.
Yes, I'm just watching some of the slipping and sliding going on through that back portion of the course. Very, very tight. This course is quite a technical course to deal with, and the short version gives you no time to relax whatsoever. On the long version of this course, you know, you've got that fairly long back straight where you can relax just a tiny little bit and get yourself together to prepare to go through the tight section of the course. But with the short course, you have no time to relax at all. So everybody has got to be, you know, on their fastest, and they've got to be aware of what's going on around them, because there are going to be a lot of cars battling for one position straight from the start, Joe.
Definitely, definitely. Now I see that we've got a little bit of chatter going on as far as wanting to possibly be in our booth from some of the drivers. Marcus Lambert is asking whether anybody would be willing to talk in the TeamSpeak server that we're on. I was wondering if maybe we'd have a chance to drag him in and talk a bit about what he expects today. If not, it's no bother, but just maybe we could check to see if he'd be willing. Sounds like our director's dragging him in. Marcus, can you hear us?
Oh, yep. Got a copy on you.
I hope we're not distracting you too much. Are you in the middle of a qualifying lap?
No, actually. I'm just sitting here watching the broadcast. I got my lap in, and I feel pretty good with it.
Awesome. I was wondering if we could bother you to get a few of your thoughts about today's race and how it's going, or how it's going to go, rather. I see currently you are, let's see where you are in qualifying.
Ninth place.
So you're pretty far up there. What do you expect to see today on the track?
It should be interesting to see how the whole lap one thing goes with the biggest race that Blondie's has ever had participation wise. It'll be the first race of the season, so people are going to be, you know, a little nervous and whatnot. But ever since this new build's come out, I've been able to grab a hold of these MX-5s relatively quickly, so hopefully I'll be trying to slip into the top 10 if I can today.
That sounds like a good plan to me. Now, you're saying that this is the biggest field they've ever had. So do you expect guys to be a little bit timid, especially with it being the first round, or do you think people are just going to be going at it from, you know, the green flag and trying to capture that championship from the very first race?
Well, I think with it being a long season, you can't really take too much of a rest, especially in the first race. You got to be able to get as many points as you can early on. And but, you know, I think it'll depend on each individual's driving style. Some people may want to just try and get a good finish this race. Some may try and want to start with a good win.
Awesome, awesome. Well, it looks like we also have Kieran Mant waiting in the wings. We might drag him in here as well. Now, Marcus, since we noticed that Jan Koemans is not in here, and I believe he was expected to be here. Do you know what happened?
I do not, actually. This is only my second race in the series. I started the last race last season, and I saw that Jan had a huge lead in the points, and I figured he was going to try and get in here and start off good this season, but I think he may have missed the opportunity to join the race.
That's a real shame. This could have big effects on the championship, I imagine. Now we have Kieran Mant in the booth with us. Kieran, can you hear us?
Yeah, loud and clear.
Excellent. Welcome to the GSRC. Let's see, where are you qualified on here?
17th, I think, yeah.
17th, so you're about middle of the pack.
Yeah.
Do you expect that to be a dangerous spot to be with such a huge field, or do you think everyone's going to keep it pretty clean?
I think the only problem would be turn 2. It gets pretty tight going through there, turn 2, turn 3, into that back straight. That will be the only sort of dangerous bit. If I can keep it clean through there, should be okay.
Definitely. I've definitely had my fair share of run-ins in that corner when in the MX5 opener league for iRacing. So, I understand that you're a bit of a newcomer to this league.
Yeah, I participated in last season, but couldn't participate in much, hoping to do a bit better in this season, hopefully finish higher than I was, but still learning the ropes in a way.
Do you expect to be fighting up with the big guys through pit strategy and whatnot, or do you think you'll be faring about midfield?
I aim for, you know, I always aim for as high as I, you know, top 10, but they do look quick, but, you know, it's all about race pace, and pit strategies could come into play here as well, especially with all the back markers. If you can get in early, it could be better if you, you know, than going in late.
Yeah, that's very true. And these cars only have, I believe, it's 3.6 gallons. They're limited on fuel. We've also got Daryl in here. Just real quick, we'll ask him a question since we've got him in. Daryl, what do you expect today?
I expect a tough race. I mean, I haven't really been sim racing long. This is my first race in the Blondie series. Looking at the times, it's going to be really close, and I'm really looking forward to it.
Awesome. We look forward to seeing how you fare on the track. It looks like we're out of time, though, as far as having some quick pre-race interviews. We've got the qualifying just about settled. There's about 45 seconds left, so we should probably wait until it's all said and done before we read it down. Richard, I'll have you go through the grid as soon as they're done. But in the meantime, this is definitely going to be an exciting day. I'm looking forward to watching my very first Blondie's race. I've been studying up on this league, and it's very, very unique in the way that they run it, and I'm looking forward to enjoying it. I imagine it's an incredibly exciting league. These cars tend to run very close with the MX-5s. We've actually got two different types of them. There's the Cup and the Roadster. Richard, what's the main difference between these two cars?
Now that is a subject that's very dear to my heart. Let me just quickly mention that in the qualifying at the moment, it looks like João Freitas, who was the fastest in practice, is back at the top of the leaderboard, and Amjad Yamin is second, with Arthur Chan third. So those were the sorts of drivers we were expecting to be up near the top of the field. But getting back to the cars, as you mentioned, there are two versions of this of the MX-5. One is called the MX-5 Cup, and the other one's the Roadster. The main difference between these two cars is the gearing. The Roadster has a totally different gearbox to the Cup car, whereas the Cup car has a 6-speed gearbox. The Roadster only has a five-speed a gearbox, and there's also a difference in the dampers, the way the car's set up. So they're quite different to drive. And I remember maybe a year or two ago when we first started, the Roadster car was actually faster than the Cup car. But it seems that with all the changes that iRacing have brought in, as I noticed the field starting to form up for the race, I'll just wrap this up very quickly. The cup car has become the faster car, and most of the drivers now prefer racing the cup car, although there are a few diehards who still love the roadster. Back to you, Joe.
Thank you. Yes, they're lining up on the grid, and the qualifying is settled now. As you said, João Freitas is on the pole with a 101.166 lap time. That is pretty damn fast. I definitely could not hit that myself. Amjad Yamin is close behind in second with a 101.586. Then we have Arthur Chan starting in third on the second row. Sam McAleer in fourth. Claudio Clima in fifth. Jared Janis in sixth. Chuck Johnson in seventh. Arcadius Tatarix in eighth. Tom Rathie in ninth, and Marcus Lambert in 10th. Then, as far as the rest of the field goes, it's Marcus Lambert, Nico Brandt, Benjamin Lanouette, Joseph Aro, Jim A. Boland, Daryl Michael Bennett, Eric Garcia, Kieran Mant, Louis Baboni, Stefan Morain, Jonathan Kier, Mihai Misesan, Peter Yrsa, Joshua Gaiman, Matthew Baker, Andy Morgan, Simon Yarres, Kelvin Stallings, Henry Conant, John Kelly, David Schaefer, Lowell Jewell, Scott Malcolm,
Green, green,
Matthias
green.
Soni Hirokanaya, and it seems we're just about going green, and
And
we
we're
are going
green.
green now. They are off. They're heading towards the first corner. John Friedis is leading the pack. He takes a bit of a defensive line. Amjad kind of takes a look, but there's nothing for it. Oh, and we've got Arthur and Sam side by side through turn one. They're heading towards the treacherous turn two. Leaders break. It seems mostly clean throughout the field. Richard, you want to take it for the rest of the lap here? I'm going to check to see
Yes,
if there's any
certainly,
trouble.
certainly. They've just gone through Redmond's, and they're heading up this slight up into the Redmond corner and into Hobbs. Very tight around here. This right-hander, you have to be really, really good on your throttle manipulation to get through here. Then it's flat out to the Mike Knight corner, and then down to the last corner where you sweep back onto the as one of the cars goes into the pits there. And it looks like at the moment we have João Freitas leading with Amjad Yaman in second, Arthur Chan in third, Joe.
Yes, it looks like a car has taken a voluntary pass through. Richard, if you want to check who that is. Zhao leads into the first turn on lap two. He's followed very closely by Amjad Yamin. He's not close enough to make anything happen, but he's definitely staying right up there. This is probably a good place to be. Ooh, he closes up in turns two and three, though. He's definitely going to be pushing Zhao, it seems. Meanwhile, Arthur Chan is about a few car lengths back, maybe about five or six, and just kind of hanging on. Behind him, Jared Janis is close enough to kind of keep the pressure on Arthur. But in the meantime, it looks like that Zhao and Amjad are just keeping it nice and tight on those first two. It's going to be a close race if they keep this up.
It looks like it was Sam McAleer that took the drive-through, and he's back out now, so back in the race again. But of course, that'll put him down a fair number of spots. So at this point in time, they've just crossed the start-finish line again. João Freitas still in the lead, followed by Amjad Yamin and then Arthur Chan. It looks like the race has been pretty clean so far, Joe.
Yeah, I'm a bit surprised by that, but it's a pleasant surprise. It's good to see these drivers having nice, clean racing. I'm scanning back through the field to see if we've got any very close battles going on. Tom Rathje is closing pretty close behind Nico Brandt. He's not close enough to do anything quite yet, but he's definitely threatening. Behind him, Daryl Michael Bennett has Joseph Aro right on top of his bumper. He is definitely threatening, and that is for position 11. In fact, he's got a very nice paint job with that sort of Ferrari shell look going on. I really dig that paint job.
Yes, I am watching the third place at the moment, which is Arthur Chan. We always thought that Arthur and Amjad would be amongst one of the fast guys, but just watching Arthur at the moment, he's not making any impression on Amjad at the moment. Our leader, of course, is still João Freitas. And it looks like it's all very clean and a little bit of a procession at the moment. But no doubt that will change as the tires warm up and everybody starts to get into their rhythm, Joe.
Definitely, and I'm pretty sure that the pitch strategy is going to mix things up a bit as different guys take different approaches. You make an interesting point on Arthur here. I see him make a little bit of a slip going into this tight, twisty section. He definitely has Jared Janis all over the back of him, and he's losing touch with the leaders. So if he's going to want to stay in this race and maybe have a hope for the lead, he's going to have to get back up with him. It's interesting that you mentioned that it's turning a bit processional, because this is a difficult track to pass on it. With it being so short and so twisty, there's not very many good chances. As they head down the front straight, this is probably the best passing opportunity. Jared doesn't really do anything. He just kind of hangs in. He's holding on behind. It's a long race, 40 laps around here. We're looking at about 45 minutes probably. And they head into turn two. Now down into the back straight. This is another portion that's probably conducive to passing. Jared just kind of lines him up, but I don't think he's close enough to do anything. He might take a peek. Nope, he's just staying in line. But he's only a car length, maybe just a little bit more than a car length behind him. So I wouldn't be surprised if Jared is just kind of holding station and waiting for the right opportunity, because you don't want to be right on top of someone's bumper.
I agree. It's a long race. It's not. It's 40 laps. They are only now on lap number 5, so there's 35 laps to go. It's a long hill.
I'm sorry, we might be having some technical problems with Richard. As I look down the field, I saw someone peeking out. It was Joseph Arrow. He was taking a little bit of a look on Daryl Michael Bennett. He's continuing to pressure him. This is still for positions 10 and 11. In fact, Joseph had another bit of a look into turn two. That's a difficult place to pass. And we've got another little bit of action here going up between... Oh, Tom Rathy takes a look on the inside of Nico Brandt into the twisty section. I'm sorry, the name of that corner escapes me at the moment. But he lost some ground there, apparently, in the attempt. Richard, are you still with us?
Yes, I'm back, Joe, and I just been watching a little incident that has happened. Arthur Chan in the number 50 car had a little slide in Hobbs Corner, and Jared Janis gave him a little bit of a touch-up in the rear. So he has got some damage on the rear of his car at the moment. So it's all action up near the front here, Joe.
With this not being the fastest of courses, I don't imagine that damage will come, much into play in these cars. Aerodynamically, this isn't the sort of course that caters to that. But if he keeps that up, that's the sort of little touches and contacts that can rattle a driver, because you know that person behind you is not afraid to race close.
Yeah, that's right. Now, we had Marcus Lambert earlier in the booth just commenting on his chances in the race. I noticed that he is up to fifth place, which is a very good showing for, did he say, was his first or second appearance in the series?
Yeah, I believe he said this is his second appearance, if I remember right. You're right, and Arthur's got a bit of a Trulli train going on there. He's got Jer and now Marcus that you mentioned right behind him. So I'm wondering if he's holding these guys up or if it's just the draft that's allowing them to close up here.
Yes, the thing about this, what makes it so competitive, nobody has a setup advantage over anyone else. They're all running the basic baseline MX-5 setup for each car, and that has to come into play, because the people who can master the baseline setup, and there are lots of them, when you start off racing, you have to start with the baseline in the NVIDIA Cup, or what used to be called the NVIDIA Cup, not quite sure what it's called now, and some people have become masters in using the baseline setup, and some of the other guys who race in other series are used to being able to tune the cars to a different setup and make them work better. And they may be finding a bit of difficulty here with the baseline setup, Joe.
Yeah, and it looks like we've got a bit of a battle going on back for position 20. Peter Yurza is very much pressuring Simon Ayres, looking at him take a little bit of a peek down the front straightaway, but he tucks back in line. They're heading towards turn one, and behind Simon, we've got another car. I'm trying to see who that is. Looks like, that is Peter Yurza. I'm sorry. Peter makes an attempt, and he's on the inside of Simon. It looks like he's got the spot. They're heading into turn two. They're still side by side. And he's got the inside, which gives them the position. Peter could still make another go, or I'm sorry, Simon could still make an attempt to get back at him here if he has a cutback, but he does not. That is a very good pass by Peter Yurza, very clean, very well done. Some good side-by-side racing there, Richard.
Okay, I'm concentrating on what's happening at the front. And I'm looking at Joao Freitas, who at this point in time seems to be well and truly in control of the race. Not surprisingly, as we said at the beginning of our broadcast, Amjad Yamin is the closest one to him, running in second place, about 1 second behind. So there's not a lot in it. Arthur Chan is still hanging on to third place, but I have a feeling Arthur Chan will be under pressure very soon from two other guys behind him, Jair Janis and Marcus Lambert. And then in the sixth place, Chuck Johnson is starting to move forward. And we know Chuck is very reliable. He's not the fastest, but he's one of the most reliable. Reminds me of somebody who I know, a guy called Joe Peak. Joe?
I have no idea who you're talking about. Definitely nobody who has any sort of reliability that I've seen. but the interesting thing about Arthur and holding these guys up, if he is, because I've noticed they've backed off just a little bit, and that could be intentional to just give them some space instead of slowing everybody down. You know, if I were them with the pit stops coming, this would be a really good opportunity for one of them to try and leapfrog Arthur. I know we'd all rather see a pass on the track, but a lot of times strategy is very important and something to keep in mind. You can't just try and continue to muscle past someone. You have to think about the big picture and think, you know, could I get to the end here and maybe pit before him, take a little bit less fuel, or maybe even pit after him and, you know, go a little bit longer. And because these cars take a long time in the pits to refuel, and maybe spend a little bit less time in the pits and get ahead of him that way. At least that's the way that I would if I was in that car, that's how I would go about it.
Yes, you're right. Well, you know, it's interesting you mentioned the pit stops. We haven't mentioned that before. These cars have 3.6 gallons of fuel, which means they are going to get about 20 or so laps before they have to pit. So it's going to be interesting. We're on lap 11 now. As we go through the next 5-6 laps, we might be seeing some people thinking about pitting, Joel.
That'll be very interesting to see who wants to play it early and who wants to run it long, and also how it plays out as far as on who gets ahead of who. We're going to check in on Simon here. Richard, do you have him pulled up? I'm trying to find him.
Simon, do you have his last name? Sorry that
Simon
we don't
Ayres.
Know.
Yes, I found him. He's down in 19th. He's still fighting with Mr. Peter Yurza, who made that excellent pass a little bit early. They've still got a battle going on, so they must be very closely paced because they're right with one another still. And right behind them, not far behind, is Mr. Andy Morgan, who's just kind of hanging in the wings, which is a good position to be when you've got a battle going in front of you. As soon as those guys make a mistake or if they slow each other down, he could be in a good position to pounce.
Yes, anybody, not too sure where the guys who are far as 15th or further back would make an impression on the leaders, but you never know when the pit stop's coming, that could play a big part in changing all the positions. But at the moment, I'm having a look at seventh place. It's car number 8, Arcadius Tetterix. Now, Arcadius is a very steady and a very fast driver. At the moment, he's in a pack of about 3 cars, very, very close to each other. Ahead of him is Chuck Johnson, and just behind him is Nico Brandt. And these guys, they're following each other at the moment, but I'm pretty sure that each one of them is just looking to see if the one in front makes a mistake so they can pounce and take over the position, Joe.
Absolutely. And we just saw Chuck grab a little bit of dirt on the exit of the final corner, which can slow you down, especially here. You want to get that exit with that long straight, very clean. And wow, Arcadius is right on him now. He had a much better exit out of that turn. He takes a little bit of peek in a two, but there's nothing doing right there. They head through the quick right left. And now Arcadius is slowed up, and he's got Nico right behind him. Nico is closing up. Did he get a good exit? No, not quite. Arcadius did a good job of getting back on it. Neo, he's back on top of Chuck. Like you said, these three are just really close, and it is probably a pressure cooker inside those cockpits right now with all of them just chomping at the bit.
You are not wrong at all, Joe. And, you know, this is really good, close racing, nice and clean, but fierce. You know, anybody makes a mistake, I'm going to have your position. And just lurking behind them is Tom Rathie in 10th place at the moment. So this race, the potential for
I'm sorry to interrupt. Oh, yes, Arcadius makes a go. Very close. He almost looked like he had the inside there. They're heading into turn two. I don't think he's close enough. He's still taking a peek. He really, really wants that spot, Richard.
I'm telling you, and Nico Brandt just behind him. I think Nico, to be honest, is the fastest of those three, and he just hasn't had an opportunity to pass, although he has a peek as they go into Hobman's. He has a little peek, but decides the better of it because the corners are really, really too tight to make any passing maneuvers stick. It could be dangerous as well, Joe.
Yeah, and speaking of which, Tom Rathie behind them goes off as he had closed up. That was a wasted opportunity for him, unfortunately. But yeah, you know, that the twisty section is really interesting because I have found you can make passes, and even if you don't, there's that really short spurt that if you hit it just right, you can kind of sneak up the inside of someone. It's dangerous, and they have to play nice with you. But it is possible to pass through that double hairpin left and right.
Yeah, it takes my mind back a little bit, Joe, to a race I was in some time ago.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but we've got pit stops. We've got Jim A. Boland in the pits here. Let me pull him up. What position is he in? He is in fifth, so he's... I'm sorry, that's car number five. He's down towards 20th and thereabouts. He's currently coming out 27th. His pit is done and dusted. Oh, I'm sorry, it appears it was a stop and go, actually, possibly. We'll see if we can confirm that. Lambert has gone from 5th to 4th, it looks like. I'm sorry. I'm just trying to confirm some information that I'm getting. In the meantime, let's take a peek back up at the top. It's still Joao Freitas who is leading, and it looks like he's coming upon lap traffic here. I'm not sure if he's already been going through it. But both him and Amjad are coming up to lapped cars, so that could come into play. That could be a possible chance for Amjad to maybe sneak by or get an opportunity. And the Pepto car, who is Bill's Soup Zahn, who is actually the organizer of this league, is trying to pull over. He might be heading in for the pits, it seems. No, he's trying to just kind of let them by. That was a bad place to do it, though. That's a very fast right-hander through the penultimate corner. The leaders head on by him. It's good of him to pull over, but I'm sure the leaders were a little bit wary as they headed through that fast corner there. I'm sorry, we seem to have some more technical problems with Richard once again.
17 laps, 18.
Oh, Richard, are you back now?
Yes, folks, I must apologize. My internet is not the greatest at the moment. I will be persevering, though, because we do love this racing. I am just quite excited by the look of what I'm seeing here at the moment. You've got Joao Freitas, you've got Amjad Yamin, you've got Arthur Chan closing up again. It's all happening, Joe.
Yeah, you know, through that traffic, it looks like Amjad is just right on top of Zhao now. I haven't been paying too close attention, so I don't know what the gap has been throughout most of the race, but he's at least within a car length and a half, maybe two car lengths of the leader. So this thing ain't over till it's over.
I tell you what, this is pack racing at its best, hey? All the same types of cars. This is not multi-class. So there's only one brand of car on the track here, and they're all pretty close. They have a fixed setup. It's anybody's race, in my opinion, Joe.
Definitely. Oh, and there's a car off in front of the leaders. Let me see if I can figure out who that is. That is Lowell Jewell. He had a spin in turns two and three there. But he gets out of everybody's way and returns to the track nice and safely. Once again, the leaders, though, are back and lapping traffic. Matthias Sioni is getting out of the way of them. And Amjad is... It looks like we're on Nico Brandt here with some fierce battling going on. Let's check that out.
We have somebody going into the pits.
Yeah, oh, it looks like Arcadius has finally gotten past Chuck. I'm not sure if we saw that on camera. I didn't quite catch it. But he has found a way past, so Arcadius is all the way up to fifth. Chuck is down to sixth, and Nico continues to follow in seventh. Nico is in sixth. And Nico takes a look at Chuck. He's very close. He is right on the bumper. Ooh, he's being very brave into that corner. He tried to outbrake him, but didn't quite have it. He's still taking a look into turn two, but there is just no way through. Oh my gosh, these cars, four cars all together, at least within probably what looks like a second of one another. It is incredibly tight racing, Richard.
Well, this is where the main battle is at the moment. The two guys up front, Zhao and Amjad, they seem to be just cruising through the lap traffic. But this is where the big battle is. Car number 87, car number 42. Love that Blondie's paintwork he's got on his car there, Joe.
Absolutely. Oh, in the meantime, though, third place Marcus Lambert has ducked into the pits. He is taking his pit, it seems, from what we're hearing on the radio chatter. He pulls
well,
in.
I'm
sorry, go ahead.
My apologies. I was just saying I'm still on this battle here. And car number 42, Nico Brandt, he is really piling the pressure on. He's Chuck Johnson in front of him, who is doing an extremely great job of keeping him out. I don't know how long it can last, Joe. Nico Brandt's the man on the move by the looks of it.
Yeah, he sure knows how to pile that pressure on, but, you know, he's dealing with plenty himself because he's got Tom Rathie right behind him. In fact, Tom is trying to find a way past in this twisty section, just like I told you. Tried to get a little bit of a spurt into that final right-hand hairpin, but just didn't have enough. They head through the penultimate corner, which is pretty much flat out if you take it just right into the final corner, and they're still all together right tight and close.
Yep. Look, we're on lap 21 now. One would imagine that they'd be looking to be pitting very soon. 3.6 gallons. I don't see them getting more than a few more laps out of the tank before they all have to pit, and that's going to throw the cat amongst the pigeons, Joe.
Very much so, and I'm seeing that Sam McAleer is also pitting in this time. Where is Sam pitting from? He's currently in 15th as he enters and slows down to the pit speed limiter, which these cars actually don't have a limiter, and that's, you know, that's one of the interesting things that also could come into play, because you could get a slowdown penalty, or not a slowdown penalty, but you know.
We've got somebody overtaking, or is it lap traffic? It's the lap traffic. I tell you what, this is insane. We've got about six or eight cars, all one behind the other and next to each other. It's crazy stuff at the front here, Joe.
Oh, I'm trying to find what you're looking at. Here we go. That seems to be the Nico and Co. once again.
That's right.
Oh,
look at them. There's a pile of them.
Yeah.
Arcadius under pressure like you wouldn't believe. You've got Nico going on the outside and then back to the inside. Arcadia's defending, not sure whether he should be defending or attacking at the moment.
I think
and
Nico just had contact with Rathji.
I heard the contact. I heard the contact. There is, look, it can only end in some sort of contact. They're too close to each other at the moment. There we've got car number 46 pulling out as they go through Hobmans to try and attempt an overtake. But again, Nico, he's not got it all his own way. Tom Rathji is right on him, Joe.
Absolutely. And, you know, this is what we were talking about. That pressure cooker is getting to people. People are sweating inside that cockpit. And Tom is really, really piling it on through the final corner. He is right on top of him. He's got the draft. I wouldn't be surprised if he peeks out a little bit and tries to outbreak him here. They're heading into turn one, and Tom is not quite close enough. He stays in line. That surprises me.
Just a little further back, we had another car pulling out and attempting an overtake. I think he's gotten away with that one, the car number 42. No, sorry, 42 is Nico Brandt. We need to look a little further back than that.
Simon Ears?
Yep. Yes.
Kieran Matt just made a good move.
All right, I'm back on Nico because I think he's the big mover in the pack at the moment, with Arcadius just in front of him. Mind you, if you look up near the top now, Chuck Johnson is in third place. So really, these are the guys fighting for third, fourth, and fifth place at the moment, Joe.
Yeah, and lap traffic pulls out of the way of Chuck right there. I was just going to say that could slow him up, but he's... The car is playing nice with him. I was trying to see who that is. But Chuck has still got Arcadius just piling on that pressure, just really close up onto him. These guys have been, you know, no more than two car lengths apart the whole race, it seems. And like you said, we are on lap 25, so it's we're in the latter half of the race, and I'm not surprised that we're starting to see things really heat up and see cars start to make passing attempts, because it's time to stop playing nice. It's time to really make some moves and be aggressive, because if you're not, you're just going to give up opportunities.
I've just seen Amjad Yamin going into the pits. Amjad Yamin has gone into the pits. We've got car number 21, Joao Freitas, still out there in first place, but he's coming up to a whole heap of lap traffic at the moment. So this race is just got it all by the looks of it, Joe.
Yeah, I'm having a hard time keeping up with everything that's going on, so you'll have to help me out there. Joao is... Go ahead.
Sorry, you go ahead.
Joao continues to lead, as we said, and he's pulling away now, but that's only because of the pit stops happening. We'll have to see how long he tries to last here. We're almost a half hour in, and as you said, they'd probably be able to make about 30 minutes on this tank, so I suspect that Joao is trying to go as long as he can and then short fuel it to make a shorter stop and try and keep his lead up. In the meantime, Chuck Johnson is about... Wow! Chuck Johnson is 14 seconds back from the leader right now. So Joao and Amjad are really in a class of their own, and that could be because of the battle that's going on between Chuck, Arcadius, Nico, and Tom.
Just remember that Amjad pitted, so he's out of the picture at the moment. I think perhaps we'll just run through the top 10. So in position number one at the moment is Joao Freitas, but bearing in mind, I don't believe he has made a pit stop yet. In second place is Chuck Johnson, and he is about 15 seconds back. He's followed by Arcadius Tetterix, who has not pitted either. Nico Brandt is in fourth place. He hasn't pitted. Tom Rathji is in fifth place, followed by Joseph Erol, Eric Garcia, Amjad Yamin. Now, there's a clue. Amjad has come out in eighth place. So it looks like pitting at this point is going to lose you up to seven places.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but Nico's got Tom making a pass on him. Oh, and he squeezes him. It's very, very tight into the left-hander.
Oh. And Joao's gone into the pits. Our leader is in the pits now.
All right. Well, Tom made a very valiant effort. Apparently it was... Oh, maybe he could have been trying to slow him down, because now Tom is actually headed into the pits. So this could be some psychological play, you know, slowing down the car in front of you, making those pressurized passes, and then pit. You slow that person up and get them rattled. And now's the time that Nico really needs to put in that fast lap, because he doesn't have anybody to defend from. He's all by himself. But he's got to shake off that pass attempt and really buckle down, make sure that he doesn't get leapfrogged by Tom.
Okay, we have João Freitas has been in the pits. He's just coming out of the pits as we speak.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but Chuck Johnson had an off. He was leading the race, even though he hasn't pitted yet, but he had an off, and Arcadius has just passed him for the lead. So we have a lead change up front. Arcadius is now, even though he has not pitted, so he is off strategy, but he is leading the race after starting, he started about sixth place or so?
That is correct. Now, I'm going to go back to João Freitas, because he has come out in seventh place. As I said, you lose about six or seven places by pitting, and one would expect him to work his way towards the front. So if we're watching him at the moment, we'll see he is back out there, and he is putting in some really good fast looking laps by the just watching him, the attitude of his car. So I expect him to move towards the front again, Joe.
You know, here's the interesting thing, though. João Freitas got leapfrogged. He is currently behind Amjad Yamin. So according to the pit strategies, Amjad's sitting pretty. He has managed to get in front of the leader.
You're not wrong. I missed that, but I notice now that the green car of Amjad Yamin is in fourth place. Bearing in mind, he pitted just a little earlier than as we watch him overtaking car number four, who's one of the back markers. So in reality, on corrected, if we correct everything, then Amjad Yamin is leading this race.
Absolutely. So that's some very clever strategy by him, and it's like I told you earlier, that is extremely important in these sort of races where everything is so super close. You can't always make it just by muscling past the guy. You got to think smart. You got to race smart. You can't just be a hot lapper. You got to be a Jenson Button instead of a Lewis Hamilton sometimes.
says Mr. Consistency.
What could I say? I have a lot of love for Jenson. In the meantime, Arcadius, who still hasn't pitted, continues to lead, but it's very close. Less than a second behind is Nico Brandt, and third is Joseph Aero. But again, these cars are all a bit mixed up due to strategy. We are currently 30 laps in, so there's about 10 laps left to go. In fact, there is exactly 10 laps left to go. Go ahead.
It's unbelievable that these guys have not pitted yet. They must be running on fumes at the moment. So if we correct our view here, we'll see that Amjad Yamin is in the lead. João Freitas is 5 seconds behind. So he's managed to, in the pits, to gain 5 seconds on João. It's going to not be that tight a finish, because I don't know that in 10 laps, João can make up 5 seconds, João.
Yeah, and you know, you have to wonder if Amjad was maybe just kind of holding station behind João, that maybe he knew he was faster, and he didn't want to risk trying to ruin things with that battle. And because he pitted, I believe, a few laps after, so he could have put some hot laps in and just sped off, and that's how he managed to get those 5 seconds, although that'd be a lot in that few of laps. I imagine he still managed to undercut him through pit time as well. In the meantime, Amjad is currently overtaking a back marker, Stefan Morain, who is an excellent, clean driver that I've raced with.
Stefan's not giving up easily. He's hanging in there, and Amjad is not. It wasn't a laid down mazer for him.
Absolutely. So, in the meantime, let's see. Well, it appears Arcadius has also pitted. He's now back to eighth. Nico Brandt takes his time in the lead. I'd have to double check. I can't recall if they have a lead lap bonus in this series. I don't know if we have the rules up here, if we could check that. Amjad Yamin is currently 13 seconds behind Nico. We might have some more technical problems with Richard here. In the meantime, I'll just hold down the fort. As I said, we've got Richard back.
Once again, apologies, folks. My internet connection is not the best tonight. Curses. That is unfortunately the situation. This is sim racing and we depend on the internet, and my internet is playing up a little bit tonight. So apologies there, guys. But I am back. I cannot believe that Nico Brandt is still out there. He has not pitted yet. He must have some special fuel in his car, Joe.
Yeah, I think maybe they'll have to test the chemicals and that and see if he passes inspection. You know, this could actually be very good for him, the fact that he's able to run it this long. And I don't know how he's managed to do that. Like you said, this is pretty impressive. If he does, let's see, we've got 7 laps to go. He doesn't have to be in the pits for very long at all. If he just has a splash and go, he could come out way higher than he was racing before, and I believe he was one of the pack that was battling for a 4th, 5th, and 6th. So he could maybe be looking at a podium. And here he goes right now. He's heading into the pits. Let's see how long he stays in. Yes, in second place, we've got Amjad Yamin still, who was 12 seconds behind, so let's see where he is currently. He's actually just passing Nico, so Amjad retakes the lead. Zhao is still 5 seconds behind, so he's a fair ways back, and with only 6 laps to go, he's going to really have to start kicking it in if he wants to catch up and make a threat for the lead. Nico Brandt is now coming out. That was a very, very quick pit. He's in 5th. And let's see, currently he's gonna come out in 5th place, it seems. I'm sorry, he's in 6th, so he got passed by Marcus Lambert on the exit, but he could still catch up to Marcus and try and take that position back. I'm kind of holding station until we get Richard back here, it seems. In the meantime, it looks like Zhao might be making a bit of an impression, so I don't know if he's listening to the broadcast and he's I kicked him into gear or what, but he's now down to 4 seconds, so Zhao could still be in this thing. It turns out, it looks like the information we're getting, that Zhao actually had a 5 second longer pit than Amjad. Oh my goodness, he knocked almost another second off of Amjad. This could still be a race here, folks. We could still see a close finish. Jerjanis is about 6 seconds back in 3rd, so he's not really threatening either. He's got a pack of cars in front of him who are kind of duking it out. I'm assuming that's lap traffic. He's probably not going to be happy about them holding him up. In the meantime, Arthur Chan is a little ways back in 4th. Marcus Lambert, as I said, is in 5th. Nico Brandt behind him, 6th. Chuck Johnson in 7th. Arcadius Tatarix in 8th. Jim A. Boland, we haven't mentioned him much, but he's done a good job of slipping himself into 9th. Daryl Michael Bennett, who we interviewed very briefly, is in 10th. And he's also got Sam McAleer behind him. And then, Sam is actually quite close behind Daryl Michael Bennett. So that's a pretty close race there. But in the meantime, we might want to step up back to the leaders anyways, because it's now down to 2.8 seconds. Zhao Freitas is reeling in Amjad Yamin. I can hear you, Richard. Richard seems to be back. You are just in time to see one of the best finishes we will probably see in a while.
Well, I have been watching the lead while we were while you were talking there. You've got Amjad out in front at the moment, but Zhao Freitas is 2.8 seconds in arrears at the moment, with a couple of cars in front of him. Third, Jerjanis, and then 4th, Arthur Chan. But keep an eye on Mr. Zhao Freitas, because I think even though there's only 4 laps to go, there might still be a bit of a fight happening. He's past the others now, so there's clear air between himself and Amjad. So let's keep an eye on these two, Joe.
You know, definitely. And I'm looking at, he didn't make a dent. That's probably because of the lap traffic. Let's see. You know, I'm curious what's ahead of Zhao. He's got a bit of clear space before the next, or I'm sorry, what's ahead of Amjad. He's got a bit of clear space before the next lap car. So at this point, it is down to raw pace. They have the same car. They have the same setup. It is who can drive this car faster with only 3 laps to go. We are really going to see who is the fastest man on track right now. Zhao is reeling him in bit by bit with the laps just ticking down. I'm pretty sure that there's going to be a battle before all is said and done.
Yes, it certainly looks that way, but I'm going to put my money on Amjad. He just needs to keep a cool head. He's got 2.8 seconds. There's only 3 laps to go. Zhao Freitas will have to do something really special, I think, or Amjad would have to make a pretty bad mistake, as he must have done. He was leading by 5 seconds. I don't think it is pure pace that has brought Zhao Freitas those 2 seconds. I think Amjad did make a slight mistake. So we'll see how these last couple of laps play out, Joe.
Yes, I actually saw on the last lap by that Amjad put 2 wheels in the dirt on the final corner on the exit. So, you know, things like that, that's going to trip him up. He's got to, like you said, he's got to keep a cool head and just run it nice and clean and just rifle off those laps. This is not the time that you want to push the car. You want to run as cool as you can be. Last time by the line, it was 2.4 seconds for Zhao Freitas, so he knocked another 0.4 off. We'll see as they come up to the final corner here what it is this time by. Visually, it's hard to tell. And, oh man, Amjad puts 2 wheels off into the dirt. I'm not sure if that's slowing him down, but I would imagine so. It's not what I would be doing. I know he's trying to push it all the way to the limit. It's now down to 2.1, so it might not be enough, but again, it's going to be very close. If Zhao can get into the draft, that could be the deciding factor here. It's lap 39. There is 2 laps left, 2.5 about. Or I'm sorry, 1.5. So, 2 seconds between them. This is too hard to call, Richard. I don't know. You just don't know what's going to happen.
Look, it's visual right now. You can actually see Zhao making up time on Amjad. I think that Amjad, there's only a lap and a bit left in it, so Amjad should just slow up half a fraction and he'll win this race. I think he's pushing too hard to try and stay ahead, and he's tripping himself up, Joe.
I would definitely agree. Let's see. Oh, he keeps it clean this time, so maybe he's listening in. Maybe he heard a bit of our advice. Let's see what it is at the line. Amjad comes and crosses, and he has got 2 seconds. Only a tenth was knocked off, so he's doing something right there. But as you said, it's now visual. I don't know if that he can make up 2 seconds and just 1 lap to go, because the white flag is, in fact, out. He heads through the right and then the left onto the back straight as Amjad leads with the white flag out. Zhao continues to try to close in. He's eking those tenths down. I don't think there's anything in it unless Amjad makes a mistake at this point. You know, crossing your fingers, commentator's curse, notwithstanding.
At this time, you know, if I'm Amjad, I've got a 1. So, you know, I can relax now. There's 1 corner left. The last corner, aptly named, and he should win it from here, Joe.
He comes and exits, and just a little bit of puff of dirt. In the meantime, Zhao is pushing it all the way to the limit. Not to be so, as Amjad takes the checkered flag for a well-earned win. Very good strategy. Zhao takes second place. Jared Janis is coming in across the line in third. Arthur Chan right behind him in fourth. Marcus Lambert as well in fifth as he crosses the line. Nico Brandt just behind him in sixth. Chuck Johnson is coming home in seventh right behind him. Sam McAleer in eighth. Jim A. Boland in ninth. And Tom Rathje in tenth. Wow, that was some finish there, Richard. It looked like it wasn't going to be much for a bit, but then they really gave us something those last few laps.
I tell you, I was holding my breath here for Amjad. Amjad, we knew, we said it at the outset of the broadcast, that he was a threat. Even though João Freitas, during the practice, he was the fastest. Amjad was about second or third in the practice session, and the same in qualifying. As a matter of fact, I'll just quickly have a look at the qualifying to see where they were. Yes, and João Freitas was the fastest. Amjad was second fastest in qualifying with Arthur third. So it was not surprising that these two were going to be fighting it out for the win in the end, all other things being equal. Joe?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, that just goes to show, it's like I was saying earlier in the race, and I hate to sound like a broken record, but strategy, strategy, strategy. You can only be so fast until you have to start thinking about how you're going to play the race out, because that's what makes the difference between the winners and the second place and the third place and so on down the line. It's not just the fastest driver that wins. It is the fastest and smartest and most strategically clever driver. And that was driven home. And, you know, as chaotic as this series can be, I really enjoyed this. I think I enjoyed it because of how chaotic it is. And it's chaotic in a good way. It's, you just don't know what's going to happen.
Well, look, it's fantastic race. We're going to have a look at the race results now. Perhaps you want to call out the top 10 for us again, Joe?
Absolutely. In the lead with brilliant strategy was Amjad Yamin. Right behind him, not to be discounted, with great pace and just a good job in general, is João Freitas. Very few mistakes from him. In third is Jared Janis. In fourth is Arthur Chan. Congratulations, Arthur. That was an excellent run. I think he's finally broken his bad luck there. In fifth is Marcus Lambert. In sixth is Nico Brandt. Seventh is Chuck Johnson. Eighth is Sam McAleer. Ninth is Jim A. Boland. Tenth is Tom Rathje. 11th is Stefan Morane. 12th is Daryl Michael Bennett. 13th is Eric Garcia. 14th is Louis Baboni. And 15th is Joseph Arrow. Richard, do you want to take us down through the rest of the field?
Certainly. In 16th place, we had Matthew Baker. We had Arkadiusz Tedderix, who I thought might have done a better job than that. He must have either had a very long pit stop or he ran into some trouble somewhere, because he really was a better driver in the early part of the race than a 17th place. In 18th place, we've got Benjamin Lanouet. That was 18th. In 19th, we had Peter Yerkes. 20th, there was Mihai Messersen. In 21st place, Kieran Mant. In 22nd, Simon Ayres. 23rd was Joshua Gaiman. 24th was Scott Malcolm. 25th was David Schaefer. 26th was Kevin Stallings. 27th was Hiro Kanaya. Mr. Steadiness, never a high achiever in terms of places in the race, but always there at the end. In 28th place, Lowell Jewell. In 29th place, the very organizer of this wonderful series. You've done a great job, Bill. The first race, I am so happy that we have taken on the Blondies broadcast, because I'm just loving this. What we saw today was absolutely wonderful. Good on you, Bill, for doing it and getting it all up and running. In 30th place, Christopher Thompson. Back to you, Joe, for the last few.
In 31st, we have Matthias Soini. 32nd, Kevin Lemberg. 33rd was Henry Conant. 34th was Andy Morgan. 35th was Claudio Klima. 36th was John Kelly. 37th was Jonathan Keir. 38th was John Ellers. 39th was Jeremy Naylor. And 40th was Elidio Pinto following up. Now, hopefully we can get a few guys in the booth for some real quick interviews here. We've got a few guys waiting in the wings. I'd love to get the podium if we can get them in. We're trying to get their attention. But overall, this was pretty entertaining. Let's see. Marcus finished fifth, so he's pretty high up. Do we want to maybe bring him in first?
Yes. While they're organizing that, let me say a big hello to Ayrton Ellis, who has finally joined us in the booth, Joe.
he was in here a while ago. He was kind of sitting behind you. He can be a bit of a creeper like that. But Unfortunately, we ran into some issues. Ayrton was supposed to join us, but he was unable to commentate on this race, but he should be here for us next week. Welcome, Ayrton. You missed a good race.
Yeah, I was just watching the stream, so I didn't miss all of it, but I unfortunately couldn't spectate the session, so I couldn't join you guys in the booth.
That's really unfortunate. Well, Marcus, you did a really good job there. You had a top five finish. That's nothing to scoff at, because there's some really fast drivers in this league.
Yeah, that first lap there, I managed to, I got lucky and started on the inside, and then two of the guys in front of me had to make mandatory stop and goes, but I ended up gaining a total of four positions on that first lap. And I know quite a few fast guys didn't even race this week, so top fives are definitely reachable for me in the right conditions, but I'm just going to keep aiming for top tens the whole season.
Now, there was some fierce battles going on up through that, like, 4th through 7th place. Were you amidst that, the Nico and Chuck, and dueling with them at any point in the race?
Actually, right when I had moved up into the 5th position, I was following Jura around the track, and I told him I was just going to follow right behind him because we were leaving that big pack behind us, and the best thing you could see in your rearview mirror is about 4 or 5 guys going hard at it because, I mean, that gave me enough room to where I was able to just ride relatively easy the rest of the race because I wasn't catching the guys in front of me, but nobody behind me was catching me, so I was able to just relax for the last couple laps.
Yeah, definitely. I feel you. I know how. I can't tell you how many times I've looked in my rearview mirror and seen guys duking it out, and just, you know, you have that little inner, yeah, you know, keep doing that. Let me get a chance to pull away.
Yep.
But looks like we have our winner waiting in the wings. So why don't we bring the top of the podium into the booth to congratulate him?
Yep.
Great.
Let
race,
me do
Marcus.
This one.
Thank you.
Have at it, Richard.
Let me. Yeah, I'll have. We'll bring MJ in. MJ.
Yes.
Yamin, well done, my friend. Well done. A well-judged race.
Thank you.
How did you see it right at the beginning when you were following Joel so closely?
I was just pacing myself. I knew traffic was going to be the big issue in this race. I just wanted to keep my cards play Mazda, you know, just ride in line and wait for my opportunity, and it came at the pit stops.
Yeah, I thought that was your strategy, and you know, the pit stops, you gained 5 seconds in that pit stop, so you certainly did that extremely well.
Yeah, I saw just a train of cars going in front of Joel. I was like, and I was thinking, I gotta pit now because I know he's gonna get stuck, and thankfully for my end, he did, and I was able to take the lead.
Yeah, that's right. Sometimes, you know, the early pit stop is the one that works, and sometimes it's the late one. Like, Joe, towards the end there, seemed to be catching you again, and I thought from watching the attitude of your car that you maybe just panicked a little bit there. Was that true? Were you feeling the pressure?
I won't lie, a little bit, but I was pacing myself. I knew I had a 5-second lead. You know, it was going to take a big mistake for me to lose that lead in about 10 laps.
Yeah, there was a stage where you lost 2 seconds in the one lap to Zhao. But, I had my money on you because I don't know if you remember me. You and I have raced together both in the Masters and in the Skip Barbers.
Yeah, I remember your name.
Yeah. Anyway, look, we want to congratulate you. I'll just ask Joe if he's got a couple of questions for you as well, Joe.
Wow, you covered most of it, definitely. So here's my question. It looks like we had 7.8 seconds in the pit for you and 12 seconds for Zhao in the pit. So were you holding back? Did you have the pace on Zhao early on, or were you just... Were you just holding on, or what was the case there? Who had the speed there? Were you faster than him?
It had to have been the fuel, because I put in 1.1 gallons, and I'm assuming since he took so long, he probably put in 2 gallons, which is way overfilling it.
Definitely.
Right.
These cars are not the quickest at refueling. As far as the early part of the race, though, you hung on pretty well there. Were you sandbagging and just waiting for the opportunity to pass in the pits?
No. I was not sandbagging. That guy is miles faster than I am.
All these guys. That's good to hear. Well, again, like I said, congratulations. That was well played. We were talking in the booth about how important strategy is, and you played it magnificently, sir. Good job.
Thank you.
Amjad, last question. Are you going to run the whole series?
I would like to, yes.
That's fantastic, because I'm looking forward to some more battles between yourself and some of the other top guys. Bearing in mind, there were some of the really fast guys were not even in this race yet.
Yeah, I know Koomans wasn't in it. Yeah, the silver filled up in like 15 minutes, so pretty shocking.
Yeah, we were expecting him, but I think what happened is that the practice filled up all the spots, and if he wanted to get in by halfway through practice, there were no spots left. So, Amjad, congratulations. A great win, mate. It was an absolute pleasure watching the battle between yourself early on and the other two guys, Zhao and Yere Yanis, Arthur Chan, who was up there in the front with you guys in the beginning, and then finally that brilliant pit stop of yours and the win. Congratulations, man.
Thank you.
Back to you, Joe.
Yes, I'm double-checking with our director to see how much time we have left to make sure we're not running over here. Looks like we have time for one more, and I know this is going to probably sound selfish, but I want to bring Arthur Chan in. Talk to him a bit, but not just because I like racing with him, but also because he finished fourth, so he did pretty good himself. He was just shy of the podium. Arthur, can you hear us?
Yep, I can hear you, no problem.
That was an excellent race by you. We were kind of commenting before the race how you've had some bad luck in the past when we've raced together, but you seem to have broken that duck on this one with a very nice fourth place, just shy of the podium.
Well, yes and no. I actually had plenty of bad luck in that race. I actually had two slowdown penalties, taking avoiding maneuver from some lapped cars. And when Yeri went past me on the pit stop, I didn't actually realize until I came back on the course and saw that it was him in front of me. I quickly realized I probably took 1 gallon too much fuel and just put me behind him. And then after that, I was just trying to get back in front of him, but I just couldn't do it. But it was a really enjoyable race, my first time with Blondies, and just the traffic management was a whole new aspect for me.
Definitely, this track really tests that with how short it is. You just you gotta catch a break one of these days, man, because you're obviously one of the faster guys out there. Did you have any really fierce battles throughout the race?
I think I had one really good pass into turn one, getting past Yuri. I think that was after I had to let him pass on my first slowdown penalty, and I just lined it up perfectly. From watching the gap, it was pretty clear that he was quicker than I was in the first half of the lap, and I was a little bit quicker on the second half. And so that was probably my best battle, and just managing the gap to him for the first half. But a couple of mistakes really set me back that one position, and hopefully I'll learn from that and not do that again next time.
Absolutely. A key to mistakes is to know not to make them again. Well, thank you, guys. Again, congratulations, Arthur, and congratulations to the podium, Amjad, Zhao, and Jer. We're going to wrap it up now. Richard, do you have any thoughts before I close it up?
All I will say is that it was an extremely enjoyable race. Very tight. Probably the fact that the course was so short brought all the cars a lot closer together. They were already passing lap traffic on lap 17, which was before half the race had even finished. So yes, very, very enjoyable, and I'm looking forward to the next one, Joe.
Me too. Well, as we close up this broadcast and get ready for our next one coming up a little bit later today, I just want to thank Blondies for sponsoring this MX5 World Tour. I also want to thank Bill Soupzan for organizing this. You did an excellent job. Thank you to our team, Richard, Giancarlo, and of course Ayrton, even though you couldn't be with us for most of the broadcast. And of course, thank you to iRacing for providing this great service. Again, I'm Joe Peek with the Global Sim Racing Channel. Thank you for tuning in. This was the Blondies MX5 World Tour. We'll see you in a bit.
Bye.